So before I begin, obviously we all know about the news. We all know why you clicked this video, okay? Cantor, he changed his name, Freedom. What is that supposed to mean? Is he tripping? Look, there's a story behind this, and really his whole life he's been struggling with a lot of adversity. And quite frankly, I have to disclose this before beginning this video because it's important. This is not a political channel, okay? Those who've clicked on this video for the first time may be curious as to what I do. I talk about NBA stuff. I talk about things that I love to talk about, which is NBA basketball, and things that I found interesting in the landscape of the NBA. Well, today I'll shift gears a little and still talk about something that's related to the NBA, and it might get me in trouble because it's going to have to do with politics. Look, I thought about making this video as impartial as possible, but now after shifting and reading through a lot of these articles and after seeing really what the story is about here, I cannot in good standing be impartial. I have to really express my opinion here, and I have to sympathize with Cantor here because it's really been a long and arduous journey up to this point where, as of the 29th of November, which is a Monday, which is going to be the day this video is published on this channel, he's going to get his US citizenship, as he passed recently his US citizenship test. And now he wants to also change his last name from being Cantor to Freedom. It's not like Cantor will be erased from his surname. He's going to have it as his middle name. So he's going to have his full name being Enes Cantor Freedom. Now, how did we get here? Was it some, you know, crazy surprise like when Ron Artest decided one day his name was going to be Meta World Peace? Now his name is Meta Sandiford Artest, but that's besides the point. I just want to express that these two stories are nothing alike. On the one hand, you have Artest saying that he wanted to change his name at the time because he wanted to bring the youth together. Who knows what that means at this point? I don't know. You tell me in the comments if you know what that means. But Cantor, on the other hand, it seems like his motive, his reasoning of doing this, is to push even further what he's been pushing now for a long time. We've seen the recent controversies with him making the comments he's made about China, about Tibet, about how Taiwan is not part of China, about how Nike is essentially enslaving millions of people overseas to make shoes for athletes to wear and for other people to buy. Yeah, we're going to get into it, guys. It's going to be a very messy video. Enes Cantor, he's been speaking out about these issues. These issues have been lurking. We've seen Daryl Morey tweet about freeing Hong Kong when the protests were happening back then in 2019, not long ago, before the whole pandemic thing happened. Yeah, but now we're still talking about China and the things they're doing and the things Nike is also doing, because, well, the problems really haven't went away, right? As a matter of fact, in Hong Kong, things seem to be getting worse, but I'm not going to be talking much about that because our focus today is on Cantor and his message, what he's been saying. And China, well, we have to be honest with ourselves. They have been doing some very nefarious things. Human rights abuses that really should be talked about further and further and further. Like, we should really emphasize how many people, millions of people in Western China, right? Parts that are supposed to be autonomously ran by, you have the Tibetans, you have the Uyghurs, and those people, they're being tortured, they're being abducted, and they're being re-educated, so to speak, right? And this is all done by the Chinese Communist Party. And Cantor is calling them out. And one thing he did, after going meeting up with some Tibetans and talking about how he should spread his message even further, well, he wore some shoes. And those shoes had some very interesting things to say, especially to one player in the NBA. Yes, you know who it is, LeBron James, King James himself. He's a big sponsor of Nike. He has a $1 billion lifetime deal with them. So Cantor thought it would be a good idea to target LeBron James and said campaign to try to push the message even further out there. Now, LeBron James, in response, really didn't say anything about it because, well, he's had history with Cantor in the past. Now we have to go back to 2017, where Cantor, at the time playing with the New York Knicks, and LeBron James playing with the Cleveland Cavaliers. Well, they dueled in a match at Madison Square Garden, and LeBron James had made comments about a rookie that was drafted by the Knicks recently. Yes, Frank Ntilikina. Some people may recall what LeBron said. Well, I'll refresh your memories for those who don't remember. He essentially said that the Knicks should have drafted rookie Dennis Smith Jr. rather than drafting Ntilikina. And of course, Cantor being a veteran, being a Knick, he wanted to defend his teammate. And so he went on Twitter and said some things that really were aimed at LeBron James. And then later in practice, he said that James' words really were disrespectful. James laughed it off, saying Enes Kanter, well, he's always got something to say. What's wrong with this guy? I don't know what's wrong with him. And this all set the stage when they were playing each other at Madison Square Garden. And James converted on an alley-oop with 40.2 seconds left in the first quarter to put the Cavs up by one. He immediately crowded Ntilikina, bumping his chest into the point guard while Ntilikina tried to free himself up to receive the inbounds pass, causing Ntilikina to shove his forearms back into LeBron James. Cantor then came in the picture. He intervened. Him and James barked at each other before the referees came in and separated them. And they were both assessed technicals at that point, and the drama would then continue into the locker rooms after the game would be finished. Cantor having this to say about the whole situation. Well, Ntilikina, he's a rookie. You call yourself king or whatever, but you can't just mess with a rookie like that. If you're gonna mess with someone, go mess with a grown man. I'll die for my teammates. Whatever happens, I'll got my teammates back because I see this team, this organization like my family. Nobody's gonna mess with it. And Cantor, he had 20 points in this game. He had 16 rebounds, but he was scoreless in the fourth quarter when Cleveland stormed back from a 15-point deficit to win the game. And so, boy, oh boy, it was a dramatic night. And when LeBron James was asked about the whole kerfuffle, he really just said nothing. We've got the win. I'm not going to say that guy's name again anyway. Cantor then responded again, saying, of course it was tough. We were up by 20-something, I think, and we gave up 40-something points in the fourth quarter. I think if you look at it, we fight really hard. We play with a lot of energy. I'll tell you one thing, this team is really special. You ain't coming to my house and playing that water bottle flip game again. I don't care who you are. What do you call yourself? King, queen, princess, whatever you are? We're going to fight. Nobody out there is going to punk us. We went out there and played our game. We're going to go out there and get better every day. And boy, LeBron James, he really had an iconic response to all of this. He said, well, I'm the king, my wife is the queen, and my daughter is the princess, so we've got all three covered. At that point, I remember very clearly LeBron being the winner in the public circles. People were really loving what LeBron had to say there, and of course, being King James himself, he was the winner in that situation. People really didn't support Cantor that much, and really the little fan base he had were mostly from a country that has a lot of people not liking him. Okay, now we have to get into, I think, the messiest part of this video. Turkish politics, geopolitical issues with not only Turkey, but other countries around the world. This is going to be messy, guys, and so strap in, put your seatbelts on, because it's going to be a very bumpy ride. And so this story takes us first to Switzerland, where Cantor was born to Turkish parents. And now he was raised in Turkey, and he went to a prep school in Turkey that is of interest to us in this video because of the leader of that prep school. And he was a leader of multiple schools across Turkey and across the world in general. And this person would be a person that Cantor would be affiliated with in his later years, notably his years in the NBA. And now we have to speak about the political clashes that were happening in Turkey in the mid-2010s. Yes, it has gotten to the time where we're going to not only talk politics, but also put some opinions out there that are going to get me in trouble with a large segment of the Turkish population. I know Turkey is very divided on this issue. I know a lot of Turkish people are going to really hate my video and dislike bomb it to death if they ever see this video surface. Well, at this point, I'm ready, I'm able, and I fully expect a lot of dislikes if this video were to ever take off. Now, let's get into it. Turkey. A man named Fethullah Gulen. I'm not sure if I pronounced it correctly, but bear with me, okay? He was first a spiritual leader, he was a cleric, an Islamic cleric, and He founded a lot of organizations, so to speak, that would center around his main organization, which was essentially to promote some of his ideas, some of his beliefs, and they were propped up as schools, I guess, and, you know, boarding schools and dormitories and stuff, so that kids can go there and learn a bunch of stuff. They would teach them physics, mathematics, all that stuff that you would get taught in normal school, but it was under the guise of this movement that would get funding from those said schools, and they would essentially handpick people from those schools to essentially become big assets in essentially what some people think is Gulen's ultimate agenda here. Yes, a conspiracy to take over a country, okay? This one man wanted to orchestrate this whole entire conspiracy to try to usurp the power and the sovereignty of Turkey and essentially make himself the absolute ruler. Or so the detractors of Gulen would say, okay? This is a narrative that's been running around now in Turkish press, in press that you can see in Russia Today. If you watch YouTube documentaries about Gulen, you'll probably see them from Russia Today, because Russia Today, being a Russian-funded news channel, is going to be taking the viewpoint of the Russian government, and the Russian government have a vested interest in aligning themselves with Turkey's Erdogan, who is the president of Turkey at the moment. And we'll get into how he became president in a moment, but first I will just expand on the conspiracy that apparently Gulen was plotting. Yes, he's had a lot of these people go through his organizations, go through his branches, and be handpicked to become special members of certain Turkish governmental agencies, military, judiciary, whatever may be the case, okay? These people would be in high-ranking positions, and what they would do is they would be aligning themselves with Gulen, giving parts of their salary to Gulen himself so that he could use the funds to essentially orchestrate this entire plan. Guess who went to one of those prep schools that I mentioned earlier? Yes, I think you know at this point. Enes Kanter, yes, he was one of the students that went through those boarding schools and those processes, and I guess he was handpicked by Gulen. Not to be a specific politician, perhaps to be in a different role. Now, Kanter's aspirations was to be in athletics, and Gulen apparently was very likened to people who aspire to be athletes, because he thought it would be a good idea to use them as vehicles to promote his beliefs and promote what he would want to see in a Turkish society, right? Again, I'm going with this narrative that's been spat out by many people. Now, Kanter ended up going in the NBA in the early 2010s. He wasn't the first Turkish to be in the NBA. He wasn't the first notable Turkish. As a matter of fact, those Raptors fans remember a particular Turkish player that played for the Raptors. Okay, so Kanter, he represents the Turkish team in 2008 to 2011. You have pictures like right here of them playing together in the Turkish national team. You have Joakim Noah being boxed out right there. Very interesting times indeed. Now, later on in 2015-ish, Kanter was blocked from playing for Turkey. He was not allowed to represent the team. And Kanter had his suspicions as to why that was the case. Kanter tweeted out that it was because of his affiliations with Gulen. Yes, his times as a student in those dormitories. Yes, those times must have been the reason why the Turkish government really pressed the Turkish national team to not allow Kanter to play. And so we see the beginning of the end in terms of Kanter's relationship with the Turkish government. You see there's been pictures surfacing of Kanter meeting now President Tayyip Erdogan, but prior to that he was the Prime Minister at the time when he shook his hand. And those pictures, well, Kanter will even recount that this is the case. He did shake his hand at one point. Now he's a sworn enemy. Kanter has relentlessly commented and criticized Erdogan and his horrific dictatorial ways. And this has come much to the chagrin of not only the people living in Turkey and many of the pro-Erdogan supporters, but also his own family. Okay, 2016. It gets dark, it gets bloody, it gets messy over there in Turkey. Erdogan, as I said before, was the Prime Minister. Well, now he became president by decree of his own word. He is now the president, and he made it so that parliament was essentially radically changed. Now he's the absolute ruler, and a lot of the laws that would have to go through a parliamentary process now has to go through him, and he's the ultimate dictator. Yes, it was a scenario that many Fagulen would be partaking in, but now apparently it's Erdogan doing so. And Erdogan and Gulen not long ago were apparently allies. Now, I'm not sure of the details there because I just read into this. I'm not really a Turkish historian here, so you guys can correct me in the comments. And I'm going to make sure to pin some of you guys if you do have some insightful things to say. But regardless, I'm going to get into the coup. Yes. 2016, okay, we all know the elections that happened in the US between Trump and Hillary, but there was a coup attempt that happened that was essentially ran by the military of Turkey, trying to overthrow Erdogan and get him out of the position he was in. Well, the coup attempt ended up failing, and so Erdogan, being even more empowered now and emboldened to do so, went after all of his enemies. As much as he could, he imprisoned so many people. Hundreds of thousands of people were, you know, put in prison, suspended, dismissed. Okay, either got fired from their job, got laid off, or just, quite frankly, tortured. Because he was really going after whoever was responsible for the coup. And Erdogan suspected that it was Fethullah Gulen that was the leader of this entire coup. And so the Turkish government, now being ran by Erdogan, and now being heavily supported by many segments of the Turkish population, now believe that anyone associated with Gulen are essentially enemies of the state. Not only that, but that they're part of a terrorist organization. Yes, those are the words from Erdogan's mouth, saying that every penny that has been contributed to Gulen is every bullet that is going to be given to those people. Okay, those people are essentially going to be killed, according to Erdogan. Now, Kantor has family in Turkey, and his family also were involved in some trouble. His father, being a professor in Turkey, was targeted by the government of Turkey due to his association with his son, and unfortunately, he was taken in and put in prison. And apparently, his father had written a statement, essentially apologizing to the president of Turkey. Yes, he apologized to the president Erdogan for having a son like Enes Kanter. Essentially, he was put in a position where he had to disown his son. And his parents, well, I guess at that point, they couldn't talk to Kanter anymore because it would run at the risk of their own life. So Kanter's father was put in prison, and this was something that would go on for years. And Kanter himself had to write a letter, and he put it out on Twitter. I'll show it right here. He talked about it. It's in Turkish. But basically, the summary of this letter, for those who want to know what he said, essentially, he wants to talk about the things that have been happening in his life personally, and he wants to say to the world. He says that he lost his family, and as a 24-year-old kid, he can no longer associate with his family, and that his new family, his new father, so to speak, is Gulen. Yes, he even put as a signature his last name in brackets, right, Kanter, and he put Enes Kanter Gulen at the end. And so Gulen was now his new last name. And so this was the time when he apparently had changed his last name, not officially, but at that time it seemed to have been a symbolic gesture to change his last name. Now he's actually going to literally change his last name. And this is where we get into present day. Now, fortunately, in 2019, his father did get released from prison. And so, fortunately for Kanter, his family is no longer being targeted. But you know who was targeted? Of course, Kanter was. Yes, Enes Kanter. And he was having a basketball camp in Indonesia. And the Indonesian police was essentially knocking at his door in the hotel room, and they wanted to talk to him. And when Kanter got wind of what was going on, well, the police told him, look, the Turkish government, they told us, look, you're a dangerous man, you're a bad man, and so we have to talk to you, we have to go see what's wrong, we have to go see what's going on. So Kanter knew he had to leave the country as soon as he could, and so he called his managers up and they booked the next flight. And so they went to Singapore, they chilled there for a couple of hours, and then they went to Romania, and that's where Kanter was detained Because his passport was apparently canceled by the Turkish government. Yes, so you have the Turkish government having a leg up on him, making sure that they can detain him and so that the authorities can get him to be extradited to Turkey so that they could punish him. Fortunately for Kanter, the NBA, the US government, I guess many different authorities, they came in and helped him out so that he could go to London. And at that point, he went to New York City. And boy, oh boy, at that point, he knew that it was at that time he had to apply for US citizenship, because now his passport, it was essentially revoked by the Turkish government. He had nowhere else to go. His home was now in the US. And when he did try to run basketball camps in a mosque in New York, officials from the Turkish consulate in New York State had intervened to put pressure on the mosque so that Kanter would no longer be able to hold his basketball camps in that mosque for the youth. But fortunately for Kanter, with the help of a representative of the New York State, he was able to hold his basketball camps somewhere else. Albeit, Kanter was still feeling the brunt of being a dissident of his home country. And so this is where we get into the present moment. Sorry, I know last time I said the same thing, but this time, I promise you, this is the end. China, they were also targeting Tibetans and Uyghurs, and those people that escaped, they managed to leave the country, were dissidents that went to mostly Western countries like the USA. And this is where Tibetans were able to meet with Kanter and share their stories. You see, because they both relate to each other. They're both dissidents from their home countries. They both think that there should be a way of working in the country that they lived in that currently is not working. Currently, there's a dictator that is taking over those countries. And that's the one thing that they all have in common when they talk to each other. And so that's why Kanter is so active in the sphere of condemning China, in the sphere of condemning Nike, because he all sees it as part of the same problem. Tyrants that are taking over people's rights, that are taking control of what people do and say, and that are quite frankly abusing and torturing and raping and doing all sorts of bad things to people. Those people need to be held accountable by the highest order of the law. And Kanter is going to push that message further and further with his last name being Freedom. Now, he partly said that it was due to also his teammates calling him that. You could see in the bubble, his jersey was also written with the words Freedom. And so perhaps this is where he got the idea of putting that as his last name. And you could also see that his experiences with Gun and his experiences with his parents, his experiences with the Turkish government also had him premeditate this plan in advance, where he put his last name as Gulen instead of Kanter because his parents had disowned him due to them being threatened by the political whims of the Turkish government. I'll be honest with you, when reading this at first, I was very skeptical of the name change because it reminded me of Metal War Peace, and that's why the video is titled the way it is. Because quite frankly, I don't see the end point. I don't see what he has to gain by changing his last name to Freedom. I mean, okay, China's gonna stop doing their crimes because you changed your last name. No. The main point is to spread his message further. And by extension, I think this video is going to be part of this. That's why in the beginning, I had to say that I'm going to be very opinionated, even though perhaps I shouldn't be. But I can't in good standing let this go. I have to express myself in this case. What the Turkish government led by Erdogan is doing is very, very bad. I cannot agree with the things that were done during those times and are still being done. Does that mean I'm a supporter of Gulen and his followers? Not really. Although I can sympathize with a guy like Kanter, I'm not really sure of the movement itself. Because again, I'm not affiliated with any of this. I'm just a neutral side. But I can't really be neutral at the same time because I do see a problem with the way Erdogan is running the country. I do see a problem with a country that is going more and more towards an extremist way of looking at the world, a more dictatorial way of ruling the world, and a more, quite frankly, scary future when you see it being allied with countries like Iran, Russia, and China. That's where we get into some trouble. And Turkey, we all know, they're a NATO ally, meaning they work with Europeans and North American countries. And so it gets very, very muddy when you see it from that perspective. Turkey is actually a pretty big player in the geopolitical sphere. Being next to Syria, we all know how they took over northeastern Syria after the Kurds defeated ISIS. And that was something that was met with a lot of backlash from US politicians and other politicians alike. And this was a moment that was also seized by Enes Kanter when he went to Capitol Hill meeting with politicians to help them seize on this moment and propose bills to sanction Turkey and pressuring then President Donald Trump to put sanctions on Turkey. Now, Trump ended up meeting up with Erdogan the day that Kanter was also talking to these representatives. So it was a very interesting thing to happen. It was a very noteworthy event. And I just thought I had to highlight it there because Kanter being a dissident of Turkey, Kanter seeing that he relates a lot to the dissidents of Tibet and relating a lot and sympathizing a lot with the Uyghurs who are quite frankly going through a mass genocide that has not been seen on this scale in a very long time. And it's very concerning and it's very disturbing. And Kanter, his story needs to be talked about more because he's putting it out there, guys. He's putting a message out there that we should all listen to. I know people don't like to be told things about activism and stuff like that, but Kanter's story really puts it in front of your face to where it really shouldn't be a matter of choice at this point. You have to reconcile with these issues because the power of China is only growing. Their influence is only widening. And so before it hits us at home, before their tentacles come into our shores, let's do something about it. And before we can do something about it, we must know what's going on. And so Kanter's story is more important than ever because it teaches us about the very things that happen in those countries, the brutal things that happen, and how we should never repeat those things in our shores, and how we should prevent those things from happening outside of our shores. Because, as Kanter would say himself, freedom is not free.